Welcome to Holman United Methodist Church, located in Los Angeles, California. We are a church that believes in the Word of God as it is manifested in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We believe in the Holy Bible, and we trust that there is a word of hope, instruction, and healing for us all. Thanks for joining us today, and let's journey together as we follow God.
Welcome to the Holman United Methodist Church, the Church of the Bells. We are located at 3320 West Adams Boulevard in the historic West Adams District of Los Angeles. The Reverend Dr. Ken J. Walden is our senior pastor, and Reverend Louis Tillman is our associate pastor. We are pleased to be in our sanctuary again, and we invite everyone to come in person to worship with us. Registrations are no longer required. Just come on down. We'd be happy to see you.
Today is the 21st Sunday after Pentecost, School Spirit Sunday, October 30th, 2022.
We encourage you to visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Type youtube.com/Holman Church in your internet browser, or you can go to YouTube directly and type Holman Church in the search box. There you will see worship services and other engaging content. We ask you to click the thumbs up button, subscribe, and then click the bell icon to receive notifications. And again, please subscribe. During these unprecedented times, we encourage you to stay safe, but also remember that churches around the world, as well as Holman, are still in need of your financial support and prayers. So we offer them for you and hope that you have a safe and blessed week.
This ministry is broadcast live on radio station KJLH 102.3 in the greater Los Angeles area. You can also view it on the Holman Church YouTube channel everywhere. This provides broad outreach opportunities to the listening and viewing audience.
We are grateful for this opportunity to be in ministry with the greater community through the generosity of our radio broadcast sponsors. We look forward to your support through your radio broadcast sponsorship to honor a loved one, celebrate a special occasion, or promote your business or event. Call Holman Church at 323-703-5868 for more information. You can also contribute online to our ministry or other activities at holmanchurch.com. Let us partner with you in sharing your news. Thank you for listening, and we now join the church service currently in progress.
Thank you.
welcome to the Holman United Methodist Church worship experience, where we believe God is still moving, God is still blessing, God is still redeeming in mysterious ways, even in our speakers. It is so good to see each and every one of you on this Sunday School Spirit Sunday. Many of you see I'm wearing Gammon Theological Seminary sweater. Many of you know that it is the only historically black United Methodist Seminary, started in 1883, located in Atlanta, Georgia. And as I'm looking around in the audience, I see your sweaters and your t-shirts representing different educational institutions, and that is wonderful. Many of you know that I've been gone for around a month serving during my military chaplaincy. I've been working at Robins Air Force Base, located in Warner Robins, Georgia, which is around 30 minutes from Macon, Georgia, around 2 hours from Atlanta, Georgia. And I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you for your support, for your encouragement. I've missed you. And I love you, and I'm glad to be back with you. I've been serving in the military now for 19 years. Next year will be my 20th year. As I get older, the military gets younger. But I'm glad to be of service to our country in that way. It is on this Sunday, that we are going to worship God, pray to God, sing to God, and Shirley will lead us in our call to worship. Please stand.
Please rise as you are able for the call to worship. What mysteries there are in God's world.
We, so sophisticated, stand in awe at the wonders of the natural world.
We look at the tiniest of seeds and wonder what will happen.
From that small seed will grow a large shrub.
Although we consider our gifts to be small and insignificant, God will use our gifts in miraculous ways. Praise the God of small seeds and mighty power. Amen. Let us join Dakota Elzein in praise and worship, singing This Little Light of Mine.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, little light of mine.
In unison, we will have our opening prayer. Holy One, you anoint us with living water so we may go to serve the world in these troubled days. You open our eyes so we will see everyone as our sisters and brothers. Seed planter, you place faith deep within us so we can bear witness to your just and loving kingdom. Your love regulates our hearts so we can welcome all in your name. Gentle Spirit, when we cannot see the way, you take us by hand so we can step forward in faith into the kingdom. You fill us with hope so we can sing God's joy all of our days. God in community, holy in one, hear us as we pray, as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We now have the prayer of confession. We confess the times we fail to involve ourselves in planting any seeds of faith in the lives of others. The times when our personal agendas become more important than yours. The times when we have denied others the opportunity to expand their faith through our lack of interest or involvement. The times when our lives become so entangled with the values of the world that we forget what you have said and done and promised. Lord Jesus Christ, we know that when we become disconnected from you, our lives become parched and unfruitful, and our faith becomes stunted and dry. Bless and renew our lives, we pray, so that we may remain connected to you at all times and in all places, strengthening our faith to expand and growing strongly and vigorously to bear the fruit of your mercy, your love, and your undying life. Amen. The prayer of assurance. God of grace, renew a right spirit in us. May the stories we share embolden us with courage and extravagant love for the work of justice and peace in the world, our nation, and our community here in Los Angeles. Again, we are going to hear from Dakota Elzein, who will sing Jesus Loves the Little Children. May we welcome her.
black and white. Red, yellow, black and white. Red, yellow, black and white. Red, yellow, black and white.
Jesus,
yellow, black and white.
Loves our little children.
Yellow, black and white.
Jesus,
yellow, black and white.
Loves our little children.
Yellow, black and white. Red and yellow, black and white. They are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the children of the world. Red, yellow, black and white. Red, yellow.
Speaking of little children, we invite all of you to join us under the tent as we celebrate the any day now, the newborn baby of the Tillman. So God's blessings upon Reverend Tillman and Jessica's expanding family. They are expecting their newborn baby any day now, and we will have a celebration, and we will just express our emotions of support and love and care as they journey through this season of their lives. Also, we are happy that we have several expecting mothers within our faith community, and many of you may know them. They are Erica Morrow, Janaea, Lauren Lamar, of course, Jessica Tillman, along with Lindsay Ross Wilcock. We know that God is still moving in miraculous ways within our Holman United Methodist Church community and beyond. And we are called as children of God to appreciate, affirm, and celebrate one another during the various seasons of our lives. We are glad that today our preacher will be our student intern by the name of Francis. I want to inform you that the last day of December, the last day of this year of 2022, will be his last day with us as our intern. His intern will be completed after that. So we pray blessings upon Francis' new chapters of life, although we've allowed him to understand that once a Holmanite, always a Holmanite. But we appreciate him so much. Let's give him a round of applause. So Francis has brought just wonderful insight and perspective, and his presence of always being willing to lead and to share has been wonderful for our time with him. And as many of you know, Holman United Methodist Church has a wonderful tradition of having interns. Reverend Lewis Chase often reminds me that around 30 years ago, he was an intern at Holman United Methodist Church, and you all helped shape and formed him, and he went on to become a wonderful leader within our denomination, leading several different churches, and we were happy that he returned. So Francis, we're not putting any pressure on you. But as the years go by, just know that you can return to us in unexpected ways. As people of God, we pray together, we sing together, we fellowship together, and we also explore the Holy Bible together.
Our scripture this morning is found in the New Testament, Mark chapter 4, verses 26 to 28. Please stand, please rise as you're able for the reading of the gospel. I invite you to follow along silently as I read the parable of the growing seed. He also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain of the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle because the harvest has come." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Let us receive the ministry of music from Melida Skeete Smith. Help us save the children. After which, Francis Serrano, our youth ministry student, will preach today's message, "The Cure for Skepticism."
Dakota Elzein for representing the Cherub Choir this morning. And I'd like to thank God for the cherubs who are on their way.
Stay. to save our children, Lord, today. Help us save our children, Lord, today.
Good morning, Holman. Oh, there's a camera. Let's just make sure. I want to say thank you again for allowing me to be part of giving the message today. But before we do that, let's open in a word of prayer. Lord, let everything I do, everything I say, glorify you in every possible way. We pray for the people in South Korea, for there's over 150 people who had passed away. Be with the families as you wrap your loving arms around them, not just to the family, but to the entire country as well. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen. So as you know, I like to usually start my message or my sermon with a joke. And so today's joke is titled The Atheist and the Bear. So this atheist was walking around the woods lost, because, you know, that's what atheists do. And then all of a sudden a bear comes out. So the atheist starts to run, and the bear starts running after it, and the bear, running faster than the atheist trips, turns over, and the bear was already right on top of him, and with its mighty paw ready to kill him, he says, "Oh my God!" And then time freezes. God comes out, and he goes, "Oh sure, now you believe in me." So God asks, "Okay, so what do you want? You want to become Christian so I can save you?" And the atheist goes, no. I spent my entire life telling people you don't exist. I don't want to look like a fool and a hypocrite. Then God said, so you want me to let the bear eat you? And he goes, no, I don't want that either. I don't want to look like lunch. So what do you want to do? And he goes, well, instead of making me Christian, can you make the bear Christian? So God goes, sure. So he snaps his fingers. The bear puts his mighty paw down, sits in its hindquarters, holds his front two paws like this, and says, "Dear Lord, bless this food I'm about to eat." Amen. Prayed for his food. Nothing wrong with that, right? First of all, I want to say thank you to everybody for being here, especially to my two friends, Mish and Wally over there. I've known them forever, and they're like family to me. So please give them a home and welcome. I want to say thank you to everybody who's watching on YouTube and to the radio station. Thank you again. And I know my students are watching on YouTube because they have a test about this tomorrow, if they paid attention or not. So many of you, I don't know if many of you know this, I'm also a martial arts instructor. So I've been in the teaching realm for many, many years now, especially during Christmas Institute, where I met Mish. So Christmas Institute is a very, very special thing, a very special place for me. That's where I found Christ. But then when my true calling really was really cultivated at Christmas Institute. Now, I know you're thinking, Christmas Institute, it sounds like a prison where they sent children for Christmas. Probably. No, it's a great Methodist tradition where we send our young people from December 26th to the 30th, where they get to fellowship with each other about Christ. But one of the things that I love about that job, being a counselor and a design team leader, is that I get to be their shepherd for just 5 days to show them about Christ. But I also get to make fun of them the whole time. I remember one time, because in Christmas Institute, or what we call CI, if you're late to any of the functions, there's usually some sort of embarrassing consequences that comes with it. And then I remember, like, maybe 100 yards away, I saw a group of young people walking towards their next event. And they were not running late. But I saw them about 100 yards away, and I did this to my watch, and I said, 10, 9. And they started running, and it was like in slow motion, dun, dun, dun. And they're running as fast as they can, and they get there, 2, 1, like, we're not late. I never said you were late. They're like, why were you counting? What, I'm not allowed to count anymore? I can count whenever I want. It's a free country. As much as I like torturing them, what I love more about it was when they discovered who Christ is. how much Christ loves them and how much Christ has sacrificed for them and how everybody in that camp has walked a similar path that they're walking on now, and they find their lifelong friends even beyond this life. So as we celebrate today, a special Sunday where we're, you know, school Sunday, I want, you know, Reverend Walden asked me to share about my school experience. So one of the things I want to first share with you guys was when I first moved to the United States. I was in third grade and, you know, literally just landed in the country just a few days prior to that. And the teacher was giving out pink and blue folders, you know, pink for the girls, blue for the boys. But because my name is Francis, which is a great name for a kid, by the way, just throwing it out there. It goes for both, I'm just saying. Because my name is Francis, my teacher gave me a pink folder. And so every day I got jumped after school. I got beaten up every single day. And not only that, because I was my English and my reading level was above average, I was ridiculed. But then I told my parents, like, Mom, Dad, I'm getting beaten up every day. And my dad said, well, then show up, go tell your teacher. That doesn't always work. In fact, in many times, it aggravates it even further. But I kept showing up. I kept going every single day. Regardless of how much I'm going to get jumped that day, I'm still showing up. Then when I started fourth grade, the leader of all the bullies was seated right next to me. And I'm like, oh, no. I was looking forward to fourth grade. And then so I turned to him. I said, hey, man, is it going to be like this, like last year? He goes, nah, you kept showing up every day. I got tired of punching you. And I'm like, that's how I get you. Your fist hurts from hitting my face. But then I also found out why he was so angry with me, because he actually didn't know how to read. The teachers kept passing him and passing him every year, and nobody took the time to show him how to read. So I took the time. And then within a month, he was reading at the level beyond our class level. Now, that's not a reflection on me, but a reflection on him, on how eager he was to learn, but he wasn't given the opportunity. And then he actually became my academic rival. I still won, though. Don't listen to him. I still won. But what was so amazing was that even though he was still considered the bully of the school, he never let anybody else bully me after that. He became my elementary school best friend. Then many, 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 many moons later, I started at Vanguard University of Southern California. And I remember during orientation dinner, the panelist that was speaking out there was saying, listen, there's a big mountain of work you have to do. But don't worry, just take it one day at a time, one assignment at a time, one classwork at a time, and you will, by the time, before you realize it, you're almost done. And I said to myself, wow, that person is such a liar. There's no way. And then I remembered in one of my first classes, my professor shared how hard it was for him to get into college. His writing was atrocious. And so was mine. Even though I can read and speak English very well, writing was not my strength. And so every time I turned in my homework to him, my paper to him, and he came back, it had so much marks on it, I couldn't even see the white on the paper anymore. And then when I turned in my final paper, it came back with all these marks on it. But there was a little mark on top with a looks like an A. I'm like, did he make a mistake? I'm like, there is a Lord. He provides miracles. My professor was blind when he was grading my paper. So I had a meeting with the professor. You know, I can't believe I'm questioning how I got that A. And I got the A in the class. And I asked him, I'm like, professor, like, how, you know, I really thought I was failing your class. He goes, no, your writing is terrible. But that's something that we can fix. Use the resources that the school has, because the school is designed to help you succeed, not to fail, only if you're willing to go do the work. And he told me something that still inspires me today. He said, there's a book in you. Now, this professor, who himself had a hard time writing, has now written several books. In fact, one of the most foremost leaders in Christology. And and that has encouraged me to continue. And now I attend Claremont School of Theology. I don't have their sweater. They don't have any. It's in my heart. It's in my heart. There's a big C. No, there's gonna be an A, right? But it's in my heart. And that has encouraged me to continue to move forward. So my sermon's title today is The Cure for Skepticism. It has been argued that the world is getting worse more and more every single day. Violence is occurring. It seems like there's no hope. I argue that violence has always existed. It's just that it's being reported more often than it has before. I still remember that tragic event of the Rodney King beating back in 1991 and how it shone a light of truth to police brutality. But now we can't turn on the TV, we can't look at social media without seeing how much we hurt each other. And it breaks my heart. And it's not because there's more of it, but there's more technology like cell phones with cameras that can record more of this and post it online. And even now, our skepticism grows because there's conspiracy theories, our leaders giving us contradicting news. But could you imagine how it was like during Jesus' time? There was no social media back then. There was no Facebook or YouTube or TikTok. There was just the word of mouth. But Jesus knew how to speak to the masses, and people knew that there's this guy who speaks with authority. Not because they saw it themselves, but because somebody else told them. Somebody else shared with them the good news. So people walked. I mean, they walked through the desert. I know there's a car written in the book because they left on their own accord. No? Okay. You'll laugh later. Right? They walked to wherever they needed to go. Because they just heard somebody say about this guy named Jesus. And when they got there, it wasn't dozens of people. It was thousands upon thousands of people arrived there just to hear Jesus speak. Now, like I said, Jesus is a miraculous speaker that he can speak to the multitude and let it be heard by different types of people. We know that there was people in that audience, in that congregation, in the multitude that was there trying to find ways to trip up Jesus, trying to find ways to give evidence to show that he was, in fact, inciting something. But Jesus was also talking to those who were seeking for something more. That's how Jesus shares his parable. Now imagine listening to this for the first time. The kingdom of God is like this. It's like a farmer scattering seeds. Then it grows. Could you imagine hearing that? Now, I'm no farmer, but I know that's not how you plant seeds, right? You have to dig a hole, drop the seed, cover the hole, water it, and then hopefully it will grow. And I'm sure there's multiple more steps beyond that, but we all know in the most basic of farming 101, that you just don't throw the seeds. That's not how things work. Now, could you imagine Jesus' haters hearing this and they're saying, really, you guys are listening to that guy? He doesn't even know how to farm. Why are you listening to him? But for those who was there with an ear to hear, was there because they knew that Jesus was speaking about something more. Now, during this time, when the book of Mark was written, where we derived this story from, this was during the greatest persecution of Christians. So during this time, the book of Mark was written specifically for two groups of people, the early believers and to the Roman Empire. Now to the Roman Empire, somehow the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the leaders of the Jewish nation, were able to convince the Roman Empire that the Christians were not a subsect of the Jewish people, but another group they were trying to rebel against Rome and overthrow Rome. But that's why the book of Mark shared this story, because he wanted to show that to Rome that the Christians are not a threat to you. They don't even know how to plant food. Right? But then the book of Mark was also sharing what is our responsibility during this time or any other time in that matter. They knew that Jesus was speaking about something else, and Jesus was saying that the kingdom of God is God's children. And it is our job to grow the kingdom. But how do we grow the kingdom? How do we scatter the seed? Brothers and sisters, let me share this couple stories with you. Once I was in a movie theater. It was a Tuesday afternoon. Now, I love going to the movies. When I was growing up, I was a sickly kid. I was in and out of the hospital, so going anything extravagant or anything extraneous was prohibitive for me. So movies was my only escape. So even as an adult, I love going to the movies. I don't mind going alone. You can't talk in a movie theater anyway, right? For those who are not laughing, you're one of those talkers, aren't you? So, but then while I was there, now the movie theater was running a special. $5 for any movie you want to see, and $1.50 for a hot dog. That's a great deal, right? But then there's this elderly gentleman in front of me who bought a ticket and a couple food and a drink, and the attendant said, "That will be $10, sir." There's no other movie theater that will let you go for just $10. Not anymore anyway, right? But I saw the man look kind of defeated, and he asked the cashier, "Is there a veteran's discount?" And the young man, I mean, it was a great deal already, folks, right? He said, "Unfortunately, no," and the elderly gentleman looked defeated. And before he could walk away, I pulled out my debit card and I gave it to that cashier. I said, "No, let me pay for this man." And he was able to go to the movies, get his food, and go inside the movie theater. And I went home. Because that's all the money I had. I was a college student at the time. I wasn't making much money yet at that time. It's all I could do. But I felt blessed. Because I can always go back next week. And there's food. My mom always said, "There's food at home. Stop going out." I am very blessed, so there's no reason for me to feel like I was missing out on something. Another time, my mom asked me to go to the laundromat and wash some comforters. Now, you know, they have those bigger machines, so it's easier for them to wash it. It's not going to damage our machine. So that's where I went. But then I saw this elderly couple. They're trying to find another 50 cents to finish their laundry batch. And I'm like, "You know what? Here you go. I just paid for it. It's 50 cents. And then after it was done and they were folding their clothes and putting it in the basket, I was afraid that they might have to walk home. So just as I was about to offer to give them a ride back as soon as my laundry is done, they loaded all their laundry to a brand new BMW 7 Series. Apparently, their money doesn't jiggle, it folds. I'm like, "Can you give me a ride? That'd be kind of nice." But I still help them. And it's not about whether they appreciate it or not, it's about what's doing what's right, because we're doing this for the Lord. We are the walking, talking billboard of Jesus Christ. We are the ones that scatters the seed. We're the one that grows the kingdom. So if you're asking me, how do we grow the kingdom? Every time we show love to our neighbors, we're scattering the seed. Every time we help others, even though they don't ask for our help, we're scattering the seed. Every time we feed the homeless, we're scattering the seed. Every time we pray in public, not be ashamed that we are Christian, we're scattering the seed. Every time we show our love to our neighbors, we're scattering the seed. And it's not standing on a soapbox judging people what they can and can't do, but showing them how much God loves them, how much God is willing to sacrifice for them. That's how we scatter the seed. Amen? Amen. And God will take care of the rest. It's not up to us how that happens. It's just up to us to scatter that seed. And when the time is ripe, when it's time to harvest, That's when we step back in and become the elders for the young believers. And you know what, ladies and gentlemen? That's what Holman has been doing from the very beginning, fostering young believers. When I first got here, I was in awe of this place, not just by the size, but by the overwhelming legacy that Holman has. Dr. King spoke here. Wow. I mean, to me, I'm like, what? And the sheer size of your campus. The church I went to in Los Angeles, Rosewood, they didn't even have a parking lot. Holman has all these resources, but what's greater than the resources, what's greater than the legacy, what's greater than the buildings is how much you all shown your love to me, your support to me. I've never felt unwanted or unwelcome here at Holman United Methodist Church, and for that, thank you very, very much. I am truly blessed. And although my appointment is coming to an end, please know that Holman will always, always have a special place in my heart, no matter where I go. I'm not, what'd you call it, a Holmanite? Holmaniac? I don't know. Right? Maybe both, right? So I want to say thank you to the congregation, to the SBRC, to Reverend Dr. Walden, to the Reverend Lewis, because there's two of them. The exemplary, I said this joke at 8 a.m. You're still laughing. I love it. That's how good they are. Look at that. The exemplary staff at Holman, the parents, and especially the youth members. Agosier, he's right there. I want to say thank you very, very much. I am truly blessed. And I know that through Reverend Lewis Tillman, the young ministry, the youth ministry will continue to thrive. So as I leave, I ask this of Holman, to continue to scatter the seed. Don't let anything dissuade you to grow the kingdom. Continue with the youth ministry as they are the planted seeds already. Continue to give them the space they need to grow, share, and get deeper in relationship with Jesus Christ. And with all the things and all the world is throwing, all the doubts and all the skepticism that the world is throwing us, there is one thing that will always be consistent, and that is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God bless you all, and thank you very, very much.
Now for our announcements. Flowers on the altar are given by Ms. Jessica Tillman, praying for a blessed labor and delivery for the expecting mothers at Holman. Janae Lauren Lamar, Erica Morrow, Jessica Tillman, and Lindsay Ross Willock. To God be the glory. HBC Summit returns to Holman Tuesday, November 1st at 7 p.m. There's still time to register for this free event. Scan the QR code on the back of your bulletin or visit https://hbcusummitla.com. The Sunday school lesson for children is available on the Holman website. Families are encouraged to share the lessons with the children. Baby Tillman is almost here. Join SPPRC at the Fellowship Hour today to celebrate this precious addition to the Holman family. Please connect with us to learn about opportunities to engage in ministry as we continue to gather, grow, serve, and invite others to live the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you for your continued partnership in ministry. God bless you.
Our brothers and sisters, we give God thanks for the exhortation by our Francis this morning. And I guess I could say that Holman is still in the soul seeding business. and we give God thanks. God has been generous to all of us. God's overwhelming, extravagant love, God's extravagant generosity to each one of us. And we return to God some of that extravagance with which God has blessed us. And so we pray. Caring God, we humble ourselves today by returning the bounty you first shared with us back to your care. We strive to increase our commitment to being thoughtful and generous people. Help us to be unassuming in our service, but bold in our witness. We pray in the name of the one who served you here on earth, Jesus, the living Christ. Amen. As a community of faith, we continue to get to learn more and more about each other. And you will notice in our liturgy today, we have a community prayer. This is an opportunity for us to get to know some of our members whom we do not see in church, but to begin to have a conversation with God about them. So every week, you are invited to submit to the church office the names of persons whom you know who are part of our community, persons who are in need of prayer. And so today, I name to you some of those persons who have been drawn to our attention and who have been receiving pastoral care. Dr. Harold Jordan, Joyce Lewis, Ovis Massey, Alfonso Rettig, and Dr. Joyce Williams. We ask that you remember in your prayers the families of persons who have gone to be with the Lord, the family of Marion Flowers, and also the family of Sam Garty. Sam is a frequent liturgist here at Holman, and he lost his brother last weekend. His brother lives in Toronto, Canada. So we lift up to our eternal God these persons. We pray, may they continue to trust in God and be made buoyant by the strength of God's grace. We pray that God will continue to sustain us and shelter us under the wings of divine love. God will hear our prayer. Amen.
Lord, we want to say thank you again to our student intern, Francis Serrano. Did an excellent job. I got to hear it twice. Amen.
Amen.
Right. We want to welcome back our senior pastor, Reverend Dr. Kim Walden, from his time as a warrior and an airman over the past 30 days. Welcome back, sir. All right. I want to encourage everyone to do these two things. One, meet us under the tent for light refreshments. But two, if you can, on Tuesday, November 1st, from 5 to 7, please meet us again under the tent for our HBCU College Fair, College Summit, I think it's gonna be a great event. We're gonna have a lot going on. It's a huge event at Holman, so please come out and show your support. And thank everyone who got the memo to wear their school spirit today on this School Spirit Sunday. Jessica and I were wondering at the first service, were we gonna be the only two? We didn't know what was gonna happen at this service, but I see all those excellent colleges and universities and high schools represented, so to God be the glory with that. Please rise if you are able and receive the benediction. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
That you have enjoyed our broadcast today and that it met a spiritual need in your life. If it was helpful, you can support this radio ministry by donating online at holmanchurch.com or by calling the church office at 323-703-5868. Again, that's 323-703-5868 or online at holmanchurch.com. That's H-O-L-M-A-N, holmanchurch.com. Holman Church is located at 3320 West Adams Boulevard. That's Adams Boulevard and 4th Avenue in the historic West Adams District of Los Angeles. We wish God's blessing on you to have a wonderful week, and thank you for sharing this time with the Holman United Methodist Church on radio station KJLH 102.3 FM. And everywhere on the internet via the Holman Church YouTube channel. Remember, you can contribute and find out more about us at holmanchurch.com. We hope to hear from you and see you soon.